From the high desert and the great American Southwest, I bid you all good evening, good morning, good afternoon, whatever the case may be, wherever you are in the world's time zones, court's in order. I'm Judge Bell. Actually, welcome to Midnight in the Desert, truth or trash version. We're going to try it anyway, see how it works out. I have an idea, and we'll see how it works out. I think it will work out well. Everybody is behaved. We have two rules for the show. No bad language. No bad language and only one call per show. That's it. Those are the only rules. Except tonight. There's going to be other rules. And I want you to listen to me. It's very important that you listen very carefully. The first thing we're going to do is jury voir dire. That's it. Voir dire. And what I'm going to do is I am going to collect four jurors from my Skype setup, MITD51. So I'm going to collect four jurors. I'm going to do a little voir dire on them, you know, ask them a couple of questions, make sure they're good jurors. And to be a good juror, you have to, number one, have a headset mic with your Skype or be using an iPhone or whatever. Good audio, right? That's qualification number one. Number two, you can have had no more than two drinks. What jury is allowed to do that? But no more than two. Small ones. Let's see. Number three, you've got to be of good character, upstanding moral citizen, and all that. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to impanel four jurors on Skype. I can do that. I can. In fact, I'll show you how I can begin to do that. Let's see if we can find one right away. Michael, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
You are. All right, Michael, turn off all devices.
All righty.
Because you'll be hearing on the air. Now, to be a juror, you have to be willing to spend an hour with us. Can you do that?
Yes, sir.
Are you of good character, Michael?
Yes.
I'm hearing something in the background. That's not good. That's distracting.
Oh, it's probably this TV. I will turn it off.
All right, that will distract other jurors. All right. You can spend an hour with us?
I can.
All right. Guess what, then? You are juror number one.
Awesome.
Okay. Juror number one. Stand by, please. Now, let's continue voir dire. Let's make it... Oh, you know what? I just screwed up. See? I am so sorry. Michael, you need to call back, please. That was my fault. Totally my fault. Dino is here, though. Dino?
Yes, I am here, Art.
Okay, Dino, you sound too loud. You need to back away from whatever it is you're too close to.
My phone must be too good.
Oh, that's good. That's now you're good.
Okay, good.
Okay. Are you qualified to be a juror, Dino?
I certainly think I should be.
Because you're upstanding?
I certainly am.
No more than two drinks?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right, Dino, you're number two. If Michael calls back, he's going to be a juror number one. Now watch how I do this, I think. Let's see. Michael, are you there? Come on now, add. This won't work if I can't add. I'm trying. Add to contact. Add to group call. Well, I tried, and it doesn't. Oh, if this doesn't work, that's going to mess up my whole scheme. It should be adding. I should be able to add, and I'm not able to add. Let me try again. Okay. John, are you there? No. And if I answer it like that, it knocks off Dino. This is just not good. Now Jack is there, right, Jack?
Yes, sir.
Okay. One more time, I'm going to try this add to group call stuff. For some reason, it doesn't seem to be doing it. Let's try it. Okay. Now we've got a caller, but we've also got one who got slammed on hold because it didn't add properly. So I'm still having to try this. I'm sorry, folks. I figured this would just work. It does on my other on my other setup. Who have I got here still?
You still got Mike.
Michael, okay. I'm really trying to figure out how to do this. And see, that's going to knock you right off again. Hello there. Michael, are you there? No. Must be Jack.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I should be able to add to group call. This is really annoying, and I'm heaven knows I'm trying to do it.
I'm patient, sir.
I'm well aware you are. There should be someone named Joe in there, but I guess not, huh? Okay. This is not working well. All right, reorientation here. All right, everybody, hold tight. We're going to change up. I think I can do it on my other Skype. I don't know why I can't do it on this Skype. It doesn't make any sense at all. So let me decline these. Let's put together our jury on the international line, MITD55. Everybody call to be on the jury, MITD55.
Yes, sir.
That's what we're going to have to. I'm sorry. I can't take your call on this line. I'm pretty sure I can do it over on this line. Now, let me try it. It's MITD55 if you want to be on the jury. So, who have I got? Kale? Is that right? Kale? Hello, Kale.
Yes, it's me.
Yes, oh, yes. You're international somewhere, right?
Yes, I'm from South Africa.
South Africa? Wow. Okay.
I am your second caller from South Africa.
You are indeed, as a matter of fact. What are you doing in South Africa? Well, you're living there. What do you do there?
I'm a programmer. I program from home.
Okay. Excellent career.
Yes.
I am so annoyed at my Skype. Kyle, you're not a Skype expert, are you?
it's about the upload speed. You have to get proper upload speed if you have.
Oh, I've got okay. Well, I've got plenty of upload speed. I really do. Can you afford to stay on here for an hour?
Yes.
And be a juror?
Yes.
Okay. Let me see if I can add now to this. Okay. And here we go. Now we should have somebody else on here. Kyle and I think it's, is it Matthew?
Hello?
Yes, hello.
Yes.
Is it Matthew?
Yes, it is Matthew.
Okay, where are you?
I'm calling from New York City.
New York City. Can you be a juror?
I can.
All right. Two drinks or less, right?
Have not.
Have not imbibed.
Have not imbibed, no.
Okay. All right. Let's see. Let's add yet another one. I think this would be Jason. Hello.
Hello.
Hi, Jason. Where are you?
I am in North Carolina, Greensboro.
Okay. Two drinks or less, right? Jason, turn off your device. You've had two drinks or less, right, Jason? Jason, I'm going to have to dump you off if you don't speak. Hello, Jason. Okay, well, unfortunately, we're going to have to knock him off, end the call. Okay, there we go. Jason should be gone. And he should be gone. Okay, there he goes. Let's continue on. Lewis, we have two jurors so far. We need four. Lewis.
Yes.
Okay. Are you a good upstanding citizen, Lewis?
I am a great upstanding citizen,
Art. Okay. Can you stay on for an hour at least?
I can stay on for an hour.
Okay. All right. Excellent. All jurors have to be quiet, by the way. We have Carl, Matthew. We had to eject Jason. And we have Lewis, so we need one more. Let's make it Brian, maybe. Hello, Brian. No? I guess not. You keep trying here. Let's see. We've got an Adam. Hello, Adam. Are you there? No, I haven't done it yet. Come on, Skype. Do your thing. I'm trying to add to group call here. And it's not letting me. So I've only got three jurors. That's really strange. Now this Skype is going nuts on me. All right, well, it's too bad because this was... Okay, now I'm... no. You know what?
Hello?
We've got three jurors. We've got Kyle, I believe Kurt, and Matthew. Is that
I'm
right?
Here.
Yes, I'm here.
Yeah, you're all there. I'm trying really hard to add one more. I need one more. It's not letting me do it. Well,
what are we going to be the juror of?
Yeah, you're going to judge the stories, and it's not going to work. All right, jurors, I thank you. We're going to have to. I'm not going to spend all night trying to make this work when it won't work. So, I'll just say thank you all for trying, and we'll do this a different way. Looks like I cannot impanel jurors on Skype because Skype won't let me add that many people. So. I tried. All right, so here is what we're going to do. I'll allow my Skype people tonight only to call MITD51 or MITD55. We have to adjust as we go here. And here's what we're going to do. We're going to take stories from callers on the phone. Now, there are some rules. The rules are as follows. They must be, or they should be, real-life stories, if possible. No UFO sightings, because a jury can't possibly decide on UFO sightings, and no ghost sightings, because a jury can't really decide on those. Now, if you were physically abducted, okay, I'll go along with that. So, I'm going to be the judge. If the story is really terrible, then I'm not even going to turn it over to a jury. If the story is interesting, compelling, fascinating, scary, whatever, I will turn it over to a jury that I will simply pick, and we'll ask truth or trash. We're going to let the people... Let's see, what am I going to do? I guess I should pick my stories from Skype. You think? See, I'm all messed up now. I really had a plan tonight, and that was to put my jury together by Skype, but apparently when this many people call Skype at one time, it loses its brain, and I don't know what it does. Anyway, so I want stories. I want good stories, and then I'm going to allow people to judge. All right, and so I'm gonna. I guess I'll take some stories. I know that people are listening on the phone. I'm gonna now take stories. So. Forget the jury idea. If you have a story, a compelling, interesting story, then I want to hear about it. Now, here's my, everybody can groan, my big speech about Skype. I shouldn't even be using it, seeing what it did to me tonight. You should actually be able to, you know, add an endless number of people. So here is my Skype deal anyway. Tonight only, everybody can call either one of the Skypes. I don't care. MITD51 or MITD55, if you have a story you want to submit to the jury. And I have a jury sitting here on the phone. All the phone lines are full. So I've got what can be a jury. Maybe I should do a little voir dire there very quickly. We'll have to do this somewhat backwards. Hello, in Allentown, hello.
Hi, Art.
Hi. Can I trust you to be a juror and stay on the line?
You could either trust me to be a juror or tell a story, either one.
Okay, you're a juror. All right?
Okay.
What is your name again? First name?
Johnny.
Johnny. Okay, Johnny. You are now juror number one, okay?
Sure.
Hold tight. All right, I'm going to this call and say hello there. What is your first name?
Hey, this is Tom from Florida.
Tom?
Yeah, from Florida.
Okay, Tom. Can you be a juror?
Absolutely.
You've not had more than two drinks?
Oh, no, not a drinker.
Upstanding dude?
Oh, yeah.
All right. You are now officially a juror. Juror number two. Juror number three is right here, possibly. Hello?
Yes, this is Big Howard from Cushato, Louisiana.
Did you say Big Howard?
Yes, sir.
Can we just call you Howard?
Yes, sir. That'd be fine.
Okay. No more than two drinks, right, Howard?
Right on the margin, too.
Yeah, all right. Right on the margin. That's fair. All right. You're on hold. And let's go to New Jersey for juror number four, maybe. Hello. Hello, in New Jersey. Going once. Yes, hello. Okay. The judge, unfortunately, has got to reject juror number four because you don't have enough of a telephone line. Uh-huh, in the nation's capital. Look at this. Washington, D.C., would you like to be a juror?
Sure.
Okay, what's your first name?
Patrick.
I'm sorry?
Patrick.
Patrick. Okay, Patrick. Okay, you are going to get to listen to stories from people on Skype, along with the rest of the jury. I'm putting you on hold right now. None of the jurors should hang up. That would be some kind of terrible disqualification or something, I don't know. Again, these stories should come from real life, if possible. They should be compelling. You can make them up. You can lie your butt off if you want to. I don't care. Just do it well. Make them believe. The jury is waiting for you at Skype. MITD51 or MITD55. That was hard. Thank you, Skype. Thanks for all that. I appreciate it. I thought I could put a whole bunch of people on hold, but apparently not. All right. I'm no Judge Ito. I'm tough, so you've got a story. We're here.
Take a walk on the wild side of midnight. From the Kingdom of Nye, this is Midnight in the Desert with Art Bell. Please call the show at 1-952-225-5278. That's 1-952-CALL-ART.
Well, all right, we're going to go to Skype, MITD51 or 55, to collect stories. Now, again, these should probably be real-life stories, and they have to be good stories. And if you're going to lie, lie like a pro, so they believe you. The whole point is to get the jury, made up of Johnny, Tom, Howard, and Patrick, somewhat skewed on the male side, it would seem, to believe you. And they're probably a pretty tough jury, I would imagine. Let me give out one more number that you can use if you have a superior story you want to tell. That would be area code 575. 208-7727. That way we can at least get one by phone. Area code 575-208-7787. We'll take stories there. In the meantime, here we go. I believe we've got James on the line. Hello, James. Hello, James.
Hello?
Yes.
Hey, Art. How are you doing?
I'm doing well. Do you have a story?
I do. I wasn't exactly sure what genre of story you're going for tonight.
But, well, look, we can't judge somebody seeing a ghost. We can't judge somebody seeing a UFO. That's not judgeable. So probably real life, something horrible, something good, something weird.
Well, I was thinking more of a ghost experience I had, but
no, see, that's not going to work. How can a jury judge that?
Yeah, no, I agree. Yeah. I agree. So I can bow out.
All right. Thank you very much. I appreciate your candor. I wish I had a gavel. I've got my nicotine lozenges, but they don't carry very much authority. Okay, let's go to Wayne. Let's see if Wayne has a story. Wayne? Hello, Wayne. Going once. Wayne, you have no audio. Hello, Wayne. Too bad. Let's go to Shane. Perhaps Shane, unlike Wayne, has audio. Hello, Shane.
Hello.
Hi there. Do you have a story?
I do have a story.
Finally. Yes, good.
What happened to me was I was able to get a little bit past the line at Area 51. It was an accident.
Oh.
I went out there. I was solely going to just go to the mailbox and eat a sandwich and look around and go back. Well,
that's what you should have done.
That's what I wanted to do, and you're right, I should have, because here's what happened. I go out there. I rented a car in Las Vegas,
mm-hmm.
took the car out there, talked to people in Rachel, Nevada to get the coordinates to know how to go out there. So I go out there,
mm-hmm.
and about 30 miles before you get to the actual place, you start seeing signs of stuff coming up, and I'm getting excited. Well, I get to the mailbox. Well, there's other people there, and they start waving at me, and I, honest to God, was not paying attention, and I hear the screaming. Well, they're screaming because I suddenly crossed the line. Well, at this point, I'm like, I don't know what to do. I can't turn around. I didn't want to draw more attention to myself, so I keep going.
Now, wait a minute. You're in a vehicle?
Yes.
Okay, you're in a vehicle.
Yeah, I'm in a vehicle, and so I crossed the line, and the people back there at the mailbox were screaming, and so I'm getting nervous. And probably less than 1 minute from the time that I crossed the line, a white truck comes up. So now I'm like, oh, man, I can't outrun it because they're going to shoot the tires out.
Right.
You know that as well as I do probably. So
Maybe worse.
Yeah. So what I did was I got out of the car and I put my hands up to let them know that I didn't have any weapons.
Right.
I didn't take a phone with me. All I had was an ID because I'd heard stories of people who would maybe try to take pictures even at that mailbox. They would sometimes get harassed if they see people.
Oh no, it's true.
Doing that, so I was like, I'm not going to do that. And so they questioned me. There's two guys. They get out of the car. They both had sidearms. They're dressed in full military gear.
Okay.
And I told them that I accidentally crossed the line back there when I was talking to other people and wasn't fully paying attention. I meant no ill. They searched me. They also had a wand, kind of looked similar to what you see at airports. They patted me down and everything. They called Lincoln County Police because I guess they help handle any trespassing that goes out there. So they come and they talk to me. And after about 30 minutes of discussion, they determined that I didn't mean any harm. I had to pay a $650 fine, plus I had to sign a contract which clearly states that I cannot get within 30 miles of that site, or the contract said will not go well.
Yeah, how do you drive on the highway?
Well, what do you mean?
I mean, how far? Well, let me ask you this: how far in were you when they got you?
I think it was time. I don't know how far I was in. I think it was, but I know it was about 2 minutes.
2 minutes of driving.
2 minutes.
All right.
From the time that I passed that to where I saw that truck.
I got it. So you had to pay a $600 fine and sign
$650 fine
and sign a contract.
Yes.
Okay. Let's see what the jury thinks. Let's go first to Johnny. Hello, Johnny. Truth or trash?
Gee, that's a tough one.
If you have any questions, by the way, as a juror, if you have any questions, you can ask.
Okay, so when the guys pulled you over, were they MPs?
They were dressed in military gear.
Nothing MP on the arm?
Not that I could see, but I was just, like, scared out of my mind at this point. I wasn't scoping them out. I just saw them. They were in camo. It looked like regular military gear, and they had sidearms. I definitely saw those guns.
Okay. Hold on. We're going to – I see what I can do now. I can put all my jurors on at once. All right, good. All of the jurors are on. Now, you asked your question, Johnny. Tom, Howard, and Patrick, do you have any questions for this story?
Yeah, I want to ask him, he made it sound like that he did realize that he was doing something wrong because of everybody screaming and telling him to stop, and he said he didn't.
And he kept going?
He couldn't turn around. Why wouldn't you just turn around?
All right.
Well, at that point, I'm committed, so it's like, well, I know I was wrong, but you might as well keep going because you know how it is. You got this thing that, well, we're already committed now, so you keep going. And so I decided to just keep going.
All right, then. Here we go. I'm going to pull. Now, hold on. I'm going to pull the jurors. Johnny, truth or trash?
I'm going to have to say trash on this one.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, I served in the military. I was in the United States Air Force. 2 minutes in, I'm surprised he... I knew guys who worked on flight crews. If you put your bag over a line, they would jack you up.
Okay.
And he didn't sound like he got very jacked up. I mean, the $650 fine is a lot, but...
Okay. All right. Well,
he was really in...
All right, Johnny. Hold it there. So trash. Tom?
I'm gonna say trash too, because he was just going to eat a sandwich and to look around and once he was doing something wrong, he wanted to continue to do something.
You got it,
wrong.
Howard.
I'm gonna go truth.
Truth.
Because I didn't hear anything in his voice, anything in the way he said, or this is the truth.
Okay. All right. We're short on time here, Patrick.
Truth.
Truth. Oh my goodness, two truths and two trashes. Caller, is it a true story or is that trash? Caller. Shane's not going to tell us.
I'm here.
Is it?
I didn't know you were talking to me.
Yeah, is it truth or trash?
It's trash.
The jury got taken for a ride.
So it was tied, yeah.
Yeah, that's right. All right, well... Good job. Thank you very much, Shane. This is Midnight in the Justice System.
In that darkest time between dusk and dawn, from the high desert, it's Art Bell's Midnight in the Desert. Now, here's Art.
Here I am. All right. The Pointer Sisters are wasting the court's time. So let's get right back to this. And we've got a story coming up. Our esteemed jury is Johnny, Tom, Howard, and Patrick. And they are patiently waiting for the next story, which is coming up right now, perhaps from Pete. Hello, Pete.
Hello, Art. Roswell's, and if I could holler at my friends at the Into Infinity board, I'd like to do that.
All right.
I believe you're a cat lover, so this is kind of a different story.
Okay.
All right. So back about 12, 13 years ago, my girlfriend and I, we got a cat, and she knew I didn't like cats. She snuck in a little cat, a kitten, and the kitten would bark like a dog.
What?
And yeah, when it was a kitten, it would bark like a dog. So we kind of jokingly named the kitten the name Retard. And I hope I don't offend anybody by this, but, you know, it's
already
just
a little offended,
name.
But go ahead.
Anyways, about 2 years later, the cat got out of the house. It was an indoor cat. It actually ended up having some indigestion problems. But it got out of the house and got stuck in a tree. And you always hear the story of cats getting stuck in trees.
Yes.
This cat was stuck up in a tree about 60 feet in the air. Okay. I did not know what to do. I called the vet. The vet actually told me to call the fire department. I called the fire department. The fire department told me to call, the animal people, control people. The animal control people told me there's really not a lot you can do. Try to just wait for it to come down.
Okay.
So, and they said, well, it would help if it would rain. This cat was stuck up in the tree for 3 days. It was summer.
Oh, good.
And
Lord.
I'm sitting out there for 3 days, calling with a bowl of food, shaking it. This cat,
right? Got
yelling
it.
Yelling his name, obviously.
Right. We've got to get to the end of the story.
Okay.
Calling him Retard.
Well,
yes.
That's it. Well, that's pretty much it. 3 days, I'm up, looking up at the tree, yelling Retard.
Yeah, I understand.
Unfortunately. But the cat actually finally did come down, and it was odd. It was 1 o'clock in the morning. I was waiting up all night long, and it started raining. It started storming. The lights went out, and I swear to you, the lights went out and there was a flash of lightning, and I'm out there with a laundry basket with a towel in it.
Yes.
And as soon as the lightning flashed, I saw him.
Retard.
He was hanging. Yes, Retard, hanging from the limb. And then lightning flashed and he, boom, gone. And then he fell into the basket. The basket fell out of my hand And then the funny part of the story is that I heard later that the neighbors were saying, hey, look, the neighbor boy's drunk again. He's out there yelling up the tree, retard. So that's the story.
And you swear that this lightning went and the cat came flying down, landed in what you had there waiting for it.
Yes, in a laundry basket with a towel in it. Knocked it out of my hand.
Right.
Knocked to the ground.
All right. Interesting story. Johnny, juror one, truth or trash?
I think for certain he was out there yelling at that tree. So I'm going to go with truth.
Truth. All right. Juror two, Tom.
I'm going to go with truth.
You also go with truth. Juror three, Howard.
I go with trash.
Trash. And juror four, Patrick.
Truth.
Truth. Man. Okay, so we've got two trashes. One trash and three truths. It looks like they believed you. So now the big question is it truth or, in fact, trash?
It is actually truth. The only thing that is trash is the punchline who I've told people the story is, yeah, the neighbor saying, the neighbor boy's out there drunk again yelling up the tree.
Yeah, you sound a little on your way tonight, too.
Yep.
Thank you very much for the call, and there you go. They believed you. You know, it's funny. I believed the first guy. I thought the first guy's story was right on the money. That's like the fine you get. That's what they do. He really had it down. He had sold me. I was sure it was true. All right. Let's see. We got a lot of people is what we got. Let's go with Jereen. Is that correct? Jereen?
That is correct.
Okay. Welcome to the show. Do you have a story?
Yes, I do.
All right. The jury listens. Proceed.
I'm in an apartment with my roommate. I'm in my room. I smoke a pipe. And when you smoke a pipe, you have a tool called a tamp. And this particular tamp was a GBD tamp. It's got a little, it looks kind of like a pipe. It's silver. It's got a little pointy thing on it that you can dig around inside, and then the other end is flat so you can push it, the tobacco down with the fire and get it all good for smoking.
Okay.
So I get ready to smoke my pipe. I keep all my pipe stuff in a little box. I open the box. My tamp isn't in there. So I start looking around, and I'm the kind of guy when I lose something, I just go bananas. I got to find it. So I'm looking around in my immediate area, like, hey, it could have fell on the floor. It may be on the desk.
Yes.
So I look around. I don't see it. I get frustrated. I'm like, okay, well, wait a minute. It's got to be here someplace.
Okay.
So I move the chair away. I get up. I start looking around. I don't see it anyplace. I go and ask my roommate. He's in the other room. I say, hey, have you seen my tent? Did I leave it out here? No, man, I haven't seen it. Great. I go back in there. Long story short, I took everything out of the room, item by item, systematically, one at a time. I get freaky when I lose stuff.
No, I know. I've done it myself.
I take everything out of the room. There's literal furniture, there are lamps, core, everything. There's nothing in the room. I'm standing in the other room. My roommate never got out of his chair. He was watching a ball game.
He thought you lost your mind.
Exactly. And I'm saying, man, it's got to be here. It's got to be here. What's the deal? He's like, oh, you left it someplace. You know, you took it somewhere, whatever. I walk back in the room, and there's my tamp in the middle of the floor.
And you think that it was placed there by...
I have no idea what happened.
You had eyes on your roommate the whole time?
He never got out of the chair. He was watching the ball game. There's only two people in the apartment.
So, in other words, some kind of entity. I mean, if you actually emptied a whole damn room, some kind of entity had to have done that. All right, fine. I'll put that to the jury. Juror number one, Johnny. Truth or trash?
Sure, I'll buy that. Could have been on the carpet and fallen off when he took it out or something.
Truth, yeah. Okay, Tom?
Truth.
Truth, really? Okay. Howard?
I smoke a pipe. I go with the truth.
Truth again. Patrick?
It's unanimous.
Truth. Okay, so they bought it hook, line, and sinker, caller. So what say you, truth or trash?
As they bought it like they should. It was truth.
Okay. Here I am telling people, thank you very much for the story, that they can lie. And look what I'm getting. I'm getting all of these apparently true stories. And now comes Sandra with a story. Hello.
Hello.
Yes, hello.
Hi. Did you say Sandra?
I did.
Hi. All right. I just want to say hi to the Bell Gab listeners.
Okay.
I spoke with you back when John Dvorak was on I'm in San Francisco, and Reed, recently you just had an earthquake, I just want to say.
Right.
So my story, it involves a bit of rock and roll. The first time I ever got on a jet plane, and how I believe I willed something to happen. Like, I believe that I willed the ability for me to meet David Bowie.
Really?
Yes. So you have to imagine.
Now, wait a minute. You're on an airplane, right?
Well, it didn't happen on the airplane, but it was my first jet.
But when you were, okay, let me get it straight. On the airplane, you concentrated on meeting David Bowie.
Yes. And even beyond when we landed, I was living in Massachusetts.
Yes.
And I was invited to go on this trip. So the whole trip was just going to be a weekend to see the very first show on his Sound and Vision tour in 1990 in Quebec City.
Okay, so what happened?
So it was also when I was living in Salem, Mass, and I had just started to understand what Wiccan religion was about.
Okay.
So I really was into the whole idea about focusing.
Yes.
Meditating, and
okay.
I used
order
that.
In the courtroom. We need to get to the end of the story here.
Sure. So I had to imagine when he was going to come out of the hotel. We were in the same hotel as him.
Yes.
For sound check. And I imagined that I was going to be either in the elevator when he got in or when he got out. And I basically had to cross through the almost half of the Quebec City to get back in time. I got to the elevator, I pushed the button, and there he was.
And there was David Bowie.
With his bodyguards.
With his bodyguard. And you did what? You said, oh my God, David.
I actually sort of nodded and curtsied. It was a really bizarre experience, but it was the most amazing thing I have ever experienced. And it's a, I have a photographic memory with things like this, so I can picture it right now.
Okay, well, I can too. All right, hold on. Jury's coming up. Juror number one, Johnny.
I have one important question, Art.
Okay.
Did you remind him of the beat?
Did I remind him of the beat?
The beat.
Bead? We're not getting...
B-A-B-E.
What is it?
It's a line from one of his performances. Did you remind me of the babe with the power, what power?
Oh.
Power of voodoo?
No.
Okay.
Truth or trash?
You believe it, so I'm going to say it's truth to you.
Truth, okay. Tom?
Yeah, she had too many details. She really sounds like she believes it, so yeah, or that it happened, so I'll say truth.
Okay, all right. Howard?
Truth.
Wow. And Patrick.
I'll say truth because of the curtsy detail.
Yeah, that was kind of a cute little detail. All right. All right. So, Sandra, now you got to own up. Is that story true or trash? Truth or trash? Sandra?
There's nothing I could make up about it.
So it's absolutely true?
Absolutely true, yeah.
All right. Well, thank you very much. I must say, I'm impressed by this jury. I want to thank you guys. We're not done with you yet, so stay there. I'm very impressed with the jury's ability to ferret out the apparent truth thus far. Let us go to James. Hello, James. Are you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay, we've got a little audio trouble. You get good and close to whatever you're talking into.
Is that better?
It is, yes, actually.
Okay.
You have a story.
All right. My story is about 5 years ago, I had real bad insomnia problem, and I was laying on my bed trying to go to sleep. And it was about 2:30 in the morning. And all of a sudden, I felt like this presence in the room. I felt like someone was watching me. And then the next thing I know, at the end of my bed, right next to my feet, I looked down right as I felt pressure at the end of the bed, and the bed actually had an indention in it where it looked like someone was sitting on the bed, but I couldn't see anybody at all. It freaked me out. I mean, I didn't go to sleep for the rest of the night. I got up, I looked around all the house. There was nobody there.
Okay.
But I swear to God.
Is that it, or is there more?
That's it.
Okay, no, I can't turn that one over to the jury. I said, you know, no ghost stories. We need things that can sort of be judged. And, you know, I'm not going to ask the jury to judge a little indentation in your bed. I'm sorry. Brock, let's see if you've got a story. Hello. Hello, Brock.
Hey, yeah, let me extinguish my device real quick.
Thank you. Even knows the lingo. That's good. Anyway, Brock, are you ready?
Yeah. I was diagnosed early on as having a conjoined twin.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay, turn your device all the way off, please.
All right.
Thank you. As a, you had a conjoined twin, really?
Yeah, and it was something they discovered when I was very young. And when I was in the fourth grade, I was interested in getting into football, because we had Pee Wee football at that time. And
maybe you should give us more of an idea of how conjoined you were. I mean, joined at the hip.
Well, see, that's it. It was at first we really didn't even know that there was a twin because I was kind of absorbed it in the womb, apparently.
Okay, I've heard of that.
And so I went in for a physical to get cleared for
football,
and the doctor saw some things on the because I had a problem, I guess, with he noticed there was problems with breathing, and so he ordered an X-ray, and that's when they found some things. Initially, they thought it may have been cancer, but then they realized that there were some teeth in there and other tissues.
Other body parts of your twin. That's incredible.
Yeah.
Okay, Brock.
So it's still in there, because they didn't really see any point in removing it. I think just one of those things.
Do you get any feedback from your co-joined twin?
Oh, no, it's dead.
It's dead?
Yeah.
So you have a twin living inside of, well, not living inside of you, but the vestiges of your twin are in there?
That's what the doctors determined.
Okay, that's a hell of a story. Let's see what our jury thinks about it. Johnny?
I'm not buying that one.
No,
false. That sounds too much like a movie.
Okay, Tom?
Oh, I'm 50-50 on it. I guess I'll say truth.
Truth, okay. Howard?
I'm the forever optimist. It's scientifically possible.
Let's
go true.
Okay, truth. Patrick?
I have a quick question, if that's all right.
Oh, sure, ask.
When the physicians found this the twin or the remnants of the twin, did they tell you what the term was for this?
The medical term?
Sure, the medical term, or even the common term that's used in scientific reporting and things like that.
It's been so long ago, I don't remember. Conjoined twin.
Co-joined twin.
Kind of what came. That's
okay.
All I remember.
That's all he knows. Truth or trash?
Because he doesn't know the terms, vanishing twin or fetal reabsorption, I doubt the story, but this is it's a real medical thing that happened, so it could be very, very well could be true. Sorry.
All right. So you would say true?
The story is entirely plausible. I don't know if this particular story is true.
Well, if you want to try to talk your other jurors out of their vote, you can do that. I mean, or into it.
No, I'm no troublemaker, Art. Sorry.
All right, so let's find out the truth. Brock, do you really have this thing in you?
No.
You got him. You got them good. Thank you very much.
All right.
Take
my
care.
Pleasure. Roswell's and Bell Gabs to you, Art.
You bet. Thank you. It sounded like it could be true until that one juror, I think it was Patrick, asked Tim for a medical term. And that sort of did it.
We've got somebody named Ron. Hello, Ron. Do you have a story for us?
Yeah, Art. I was in my 20s, early 20s. I was driving in upstate New York.
Yes.
And very late at night, maybe, you know, early in the morning, 3 a.m. or so. And I'm driving, and it's all of a sudden the sky lights up for like 3 seconds, and then it stops. And I'm like, okay, whatever. And I'm saying, like, you know, you've seen like lightning storms. I mean, have you seen it when it lights the entire sky?
I have, yes.
Okay, so it was like that, and I'm driving, and as I'm driving, this keeps on occurring at random, seems like random times. And then all of a sudden, well, before I get to it, I'm looking and I see all the houses' lights as I'm driving through this little farm area. They all like turned off every time the light shone in the sky. And so then I just kept driving. I looked over to my left and I saw this farmer's field. And there was this massive dome of light. It was like a half of a sphere right in the farmland. And I looked over there and I was like, what the heck is that? And I kind of like forgot about it for a while, or I just talked myself out of it.
Remember now, we're not doing UFO sightings.
I'm not sure if it was a UFO or not.
Yeah.
It could have been like a transformer or something in the middle of.
But there's no way a jury can judge that story.
Ugh.
Not really. That's why I said no UFO sightings, no ghost sightings, because how is a jury going to know? Now, if you were abducted, taken by a spacecraft, we'll take that kind of story. Otherwise, real life stories. This is Midnight in the Desert. Going to very quickly, I think, thank our jurors. They have been wonderful, and we're going to impanel another jury. So let me do this, and I want to say thank you, jurors. You have been all wonderful, and I appreciate your having, sat in judgment.
Thanks, Art.
It was awesome.
Right, thank you all.
Thanks for having us.
Right, take care.
Thanks.
All right, there we go. So now I'm going to impanel another jury. This will just take but a moment, and then we'll get the break out of the way. Let's start with you, whoever you are. Brandon?
Is this me?
It is you.
Well, hi, my name is Sharon. I'm calling from Winnipeg, Canada. And Art Bell, is this the night where people can just call in and talk about anything?
Well, no, it isn't. Hon, we're looking for jurors.
You're looking for jurors?
Yes.
For
to judge people's stories.
Oh, well, what I'll do is, because I have two ears and one mouth, maybe I'll listen.
Okay, so you want to be a juror?
Sure.
Okay, all right. You are now juror number one, so you have to sort of be silent and listen to the stories, okay?
Yes.
I now christen you juror number one. Okay. In Kansas City, do we have a juror here? Hello?
Oh, is that me?
That's you, yes.
Oh, I was calling up with a story.
Okay, well, no. This is for jurors.
I'll be a juror.
You will, huh? Okay, what is your first name?
Steve Chaga.
No.
Steve.
Steve. All right, you can be a good juror, Steve. You haven't had too much to drink.
You know it. I've got my detector on.
I don't know it, but I'll take your word for it for the moment, anyway. All right. So Wells Fargo or something like that?
Oh, hey. Hi. This is Lewis.
Lewis?
Hey, yes.
You're going to be a juror, Lewis?
Yes,
juror. Are you a fair person?
I am a fair person.
Okay. That's enough. See how easy it is. One more. I need one more. Hello there. Hello?
Hello.
Yes. What is your first name, please?
Ed.
Ed? Can you be a good juror, Ed?
Yes, I can, sir.
You can afford to hang on through the hour and judge people.
I sure can.
All right. We now have our
Let me see here. We now have our four jurors. Sharon, Steve, I'm glad we finally got a female, Lewis, and Ed. So the stories will be coming up in a moment. Right now, we're going to take the break so we get it out of the way. From the high deserts in the great American Southwest, this is Justice. Sort of. If you're coming in on Skype, you better have a good story.
Kingdom of Nye in the high desert. This is Midnight in the Desert with Art Bell. Please ring Art's Bell at 1-952-225-5278. That's 1-952-CALL-ART.
Okay, we're doing Truth or Trash. You can make up a story, you can lie your butt off if you want to, or you can tell an absolutely true story, but it should be wild no matter what it is. I'm still thinking of the cat falling out of the tree into the... Anyway. All right, we've got our jury, Sharon, Steve, Lewis, and Ed, and now come the storytellers. Let's go to Jim. Hello, Jim.
Hello, can you hear me okay?
I can hear you. If you're at a computer, just get good and close to the microphone, please.
How's this?
Good.
Very good. Good evening, everybody.
Evening.
Here's my story. This happened... it's been quite a few years now since this happened, but it was quite a remarkable evening. I was living with a gal at the time, and it was just a normal summer evening. I was lying on the bed, and she was going back and forth between the bathroom and the entrance to the room, and we were having a conversation. And so she was leaning against the door, and we were talking about nothing in particular, and all of a sudden... out of this corner of my eye, I see this ball of light. It's about was about the size of a, between the size of a marble and a golf ball. It was brilliant, and it was it looked like a miniature sun. It came streaming in through the window. It slammed into the wand of the mini blind, which was the mini blind on the window, right. And sent it flying up, and then it ricocheted a couple of times. It disappeared into the floor. Meanwhile, the mini blind was just left swinging back and forth. So there was a literal physical effect from this ball of light. Mind you, there was no, I know about ball lightning, there was no weather in the area that night. It was a clear night.
Okay, did your girlfriend see all this?
He saw it too. We both saw it, and we were both left with our mouths agape at what we had just witnessed.
And there is your story, right?
That's my story. To this day, I don't know what caused it.
All right. Sharon, Sharon, do you think that's truth or trash? Sharon? Where is Sharon? Guess we lost Sharon.
I'm here.
Oh, you are there. When you got to be there, Sharon, when we call you.
Yeah.
Truth or trash, Sharon?
I would say it's trash.
Oh, trash, really? Okay. Steve?
There is your story.
We're talking it over with the tune-in chat room. They say trash.
Trash. Okay, Lewis?
I say trash. I mean, I, it sounds like he believes it, but, I mean, yeah.
Yeah, okay. Ed?
Trash as well.
Trash, okay. Well, I'm afraid they don't quite believe you, Jim. So what is the truth? Is it truth or trash?
It's 100% true. Witnessed by two people.
Yeah.
Absolutely and completely true.
You got them. All right, congratulations. You got that's amazing. Okay, well, maybe this jury is just not made up of what the other jury was. Let me bring the jury back. Somebody's got an awful lot of noise in the background. Who's that?
That must be me, Art.
Okay. Oh, really? I hate to eliminate the only female on the jury. I really do, but there's so much noise coming from you.
Oh, okay.
Oh, it's better now.
Oh.
Okay, so all right, we're gonna let you stay on the jury for now, Sharon, all right?
Okay.
All right, stay right there. Okay, let's go to our next storyteller, who would be Richard.
Hey, Art.
Oh, my God. Now, you've got a lot of noise.
Yeah, I'm driving a truck in Montana. If it's not good, I'll let you go.
Well, how good is your story, Richard?
Well, it's pretty good. I'll make it really quick.
Okay, good.
Me and a friend were working for a place putting in cell phone towers. We're pouring a concrete base.
Yes.
And we couldn't get the concrete trucks up there, so we were flying it up with helicopters. And so about halfway through the day, my friend's pulling the handle on the bucket to release it.
Right.
Well, his finger gets wedged in there, and he grabs on with the other hand, and the helicopter goes up, and so he just grabs on, and then the handle releases about 10 foot in the air. But he just kept hanging on, and he got up about 500 foot in the air before we could let the helicopter know he was on there.
Oh, my God, and he's hanging. Wait a minute. He's hanging from his finger?
Well, not from his finger. He grabbed on with both hands.
Both hands. He's hanging on to the helicopter 500 feet in the air.
Right. And we let the kid know that had a radio to talk to him if there was somebody on there. And so he just kind of stopped and let him down, and my friend got down to the ground, jumped off, and ran back up the hill, and we just kept working the rest of the day, but I wish I had a video of it. It was crazy.
All right. Well told. Jury, Sharon, truth or trash?
Well, I'm going to say truth because he's being specific.
Okay. Very specific. Steve?
It's a very interesting story, but I think he's pulling my finger. I would say trash.
Trash. Okay. Lewis?
I'm going to say trash as well.
Trash. Okay. And Ed?
I'm going to say truth. It was very specific.
It's a very split jury.
Give the benefit of the doubt.
Okay, well, there you have it. All right, thank you, jury. It's a split decision, my friend, to say truth, to say trash. What, in fact, is the truth?
It's absolutely true, and my bosses were scared the BLM guy was going to find out, run us off.
Oh, man, what a story. All right, Richard, you're really in a truck?
I'm really in a truck. Here.
Unbelievable. Hey, listen, get on the CB and let them know we're back.
I don't have CBs. I got cell phones now.
What kind of truck doesn't have a CB? Okay, all right. Thank you, Richard.
All right.
See you later. That's amazing that we get people like that on a truck. That is really cool. All right, let's try Tyler, I think. Hello, Tyler.
Hello, Art.
Hello. Speak up
Sorry.
A little bit.
Sorry, I was turning my radio off.
That's good. You're good now.
Okay, quick story. Starts back when I was 14. Me and my buddy would go camping at his dad's kind of boathouse on a lake.
Right.
Pretty short distance from our city.
Right.
Anyway, the way it started was, you know, adolescent boys would like to stay up at night and just kind of walk the camp trails. We thought we were tough, you know, without flashlights or lanterns, anything like that. Sorry, I'm still, like, just thinking about it kind of gets me going again.
That's right.
But we're walking, it's, you know, moonlit night, and we're just kind of, you know, BSing while we're doing it. From all of a sudden, we see in between the trees and the path, we see a large figure jump from tree to tree.
From tree,
kind of like when you see one of those monkeys in
yes.
National Geographic just launching
right.
back and forth.
Right.
We basically just get startled because we don't know what it is. And then all of a sudden we just see two, I mean, I'm not kidding you, Art, two red eyes staring at us from the top of the tree.
You know I hate red eyes.
Yeah, I tell you, I'm there with you, buddy. And it just started emitting some kind of mix between a howl and hiss, and it just basically at that point we just hightailed it, stumbling through the dark, barely making it back to the campsite, and just, you know, commenced to try and get a shred of sleep for the rest of the night. But just still, I laid in my sleeping bag, pretty much what you would do when you just zip it over your face and
uh-huh.
pretend like it's not there. And the next morning, the park ranger came around, you know, checking on the sites and everything, and said that there had been a lot of commotion last night, and Sorry, it's just kind of hard to put it. Basically, there were some animal remains that had kind of looked like a predator had attacked it.
Well, I'm glad that they weren't remains of your buddies.
Yeah, myself included as well. But that's my story. I mean,
all right.
I've been out in the wilderness before. I know what a cougar sounds like because
right.
we have a lot of them in our area. And I can tell you for sure, Art, that was not a cougar
okay.
at all.
All right. No, it's a good story, actually. All right, jury. Sharon, what did you think of that, truth or trash?
Well, a darn good story, but something's telling me, I want to say it's true, but I'm going to say false.
Okay, trash. Steve?
Trash.
I'm leaning towards true. I think you saw a big musky ape out there. I think you're saying true.
True. Okay. Yes. Lewis?
I'm going to give him the benefit of the doubt and say that it's true just because I've seen some weird stuff while I'm out camping, so I feel you, man.
Whatever it was big, that's for sure.
Yes.
All right, Ed?
I'm going to go with trash. There was a lot of hesitation in his voice as he was telling the story, so either he was making it up as he was going or it was nervousness.
So we have a split jury. I guess under normal circumstances, you have to let people like that go. However... let's bring him back and find out, is it truth or is it trash?
It was completely trash, Hard.
You got him. You got him good, too. At least two of them. All right. Thank you very, very much for the story.
Thanks, Hard.
And take care. Well told. You see, it can be an absolute lie. You don't have to tell the truth here. If you've got something good enough, well, yeah, sure, let it fly. But if you want to make something up, this is the time for lying. I believe it's Tom. Hello, Tom. T-H-O-M? Tom? Yep. Go on. All right, too bad. Let's see. Manila Thriller.
You got him.
Hello?
Hello?
Yes, turn off your device, please.
I will, Art.
Okay.
Thanks very much for the story.
Okay.
I'm here.
All right, good. Where are you calling from?
I am calling from Burbank, California.
Burbank. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Excellent. Do you have a story?
I sure do.
All right. Let her rip.
Story. It's a true story. You guys are going to hear the truth tonight.
All right. Well,
okay.
I mean,
so
how can we know?
Relate to this, and I'll keep it PG.
Okay.
I was 17.
Mm-hmm.
We were cruising through the Sunset Strip looking for some action at 17, me and my cousins and some friends. And we saw these two beautiful girls walking down the street that were over 6 foot tall. With their heels on, and they were done up. So, you know, we circled around a couple times, and we started chatting up to them. So they took us back to a hotel, and, you know, there was four of us. We're all 17, 18, 19, like that. I was 17.
There were four of you?
There were four of us.
Two of them?
Two women.
And they took you to the hotel?
Off. You know, they weren't threatened. We weren't threatened by them, so...
Okay.
You know, we're just looking to have a good time. It's a long time ago.
I get it.
And so, you know, they were actually business people, you know, business ladies. So I got my choice. So I picked Portia. And Portia took me over to her part of the room. And we did our thing. And, you know, I felt really good about myself. I was like, wow, this is, you know, I mean, she was gorgeous, like being with a Playboy bunny. And I was like, dang, I felt good. So then, you know, I went and waited in the living room and, you know, a few hours went by, we're drinking with these girls and stuff. And, all of a sudden the other girl started going, oh my gosh, oh my gosh, oh my gosh, I can't believe it, I can't believe it. And I was like, got kind of concerned. I'm like, what? She's like, I can't believe it, I can't believe it. I've known her forever. I said, what? She goes, I can't tell you, I can't tell you. And I'm like, what is it? She goes, it's a man. And I'm like, oh my gosh.
Wait.
It's a man.
Like, so who's the man? Portia?
Portia, the one I chose of the
oh
two
my
is 50-50, and I picked the man.
All right. And that's your story.
That's my tranny tale.
All right, hold on. Oh my lord. yeah, I know. I agree with you, jury. Sharon, truth or trash?
Well, it's a bit too much information for me, but I'm going to trash it.
You trash. A story that good and you trash it. All right, Steve?
Well, it's hard for me to say. He's been hitting the chaga. I think it's true.
You think it's true?
I think he got buffaloed, yes.
Oh, brother. Lewis?
I'm going to say it's true because I know what happens on the Sunset Strip.
Yeah, that's true. Ed?
I'm going to say trash, and I hope it is for his sake, because why would you ever admit to anything like that? I'd take that from my grave.
I don't know. We're going to find out, though. So let's see. We've got trash, true, trash. Again, we're split. This jury splits a lot. All right. They're absolutely split, buddy, over your story. So I guess we have to ask you what – I'm going to bring the jury in.
Trendy talk.
Is it the truth or is it absolute trash?
Okay, Art, just let me preface. Okay. Fast forward 25 years. I'm in France, going to the Moulin Rouge. Same thing happens. Two gorgeous.
No. No. You can't tell two stories.
So it's true, Art.
It's true?
It is a true story. And my nickname was Sunset for many years
all
after
right.
that.
Yeah, well, jury, do you feel sorry for him?
No, I don't.
No.
It's a 21st century, Art. Anything goes.
Yeah, apparently so.
That's a good thing.
All right, I don't know what to do with that. Oh, God, let's go on to the next storyteller. This would be, it looks like a ham radio call letters or something. Hello? Are you there? Hello? Well, whatever you are, you have no audio, so I can't talk to you. Let's go to Ralph and say hello, Ralph.
Hello.
Ralph, turn your device off.
I'm turning it off.
Okay.
Okay, got it off, yes.
Excellent. All right, do you have a story?
I sure do.
Still working on that last one. Okay, so proceed. The jury listen.
This happened about 20 years ago. I picked up a car for my daughter. She was going to school in Alabama. I lived in Georgia. There's a manual car driving the car from Alabama to Georgia. It's a 4-lane highway.
Yes.
And it was a manual shift car.
Right.
And on the way there, it started to have problems. The clutch was giving me problems, so I pulled off the side of the road. And I just passed a town about maybe a mile or so back. So I got out of the car and figured, I'll walk back towards that town because I knew someone was behind me.
Right.
So anyways, all of a sudden, I turned around and here's the car rolling down towards me.
Oh, my God.
And all of a sudden, if the wheels turn on the car for some reason, go across the 2-lane highway, actually a 4-lane highway, go across the two lanes and ended up in the middle. So I don't know what made me turn around, but something made me turn around. So that's my story.
So your car roll. It was on a hill, right?
Well, it was sort of on a hill, not a very big hill. It was pretty flat, but it was on a hill. But, you know, I know the clutch went out, and I thought I put it in gear when I pulled on the side of the road, but obviously I didn't, or it came out of gear, and it started rolling back towards me, so...
And then
I turned around and seen it coming. So
you saw your own car coming at you.
Right.
It did a left or a right turn, went across two lanes, and stopped in the middle.
And stopped in the middle in the ditch in the middle in between the divided highway.
That's pretty weird. All right, jury, what do you think, Sharon?
Well, I'm glad you turned around. I'm going to say this is a true story.
Okay, Steve.
Yep, I've done that same thing after working all night. I was exhausted, and I didn't set the brake good or something. The car was rolling.
Okay. Lewis?
I'm going to say true as well.
Okay, and Ed?
I'll say true as well. Probably forgot to put the brake on.
All right, that is that four jurors saying absolute truth. So what is it, caller? Truth or trash? Well...
And I'm glad you took my call. Good talk to you again. I'm a fellow Trumpian.
Wait a minute. Wait. Is it truth, the story? Is it truth or trash?
Yes, it's true.
It's true. Okay, all right. Yeah. Thank you very much for the call, and take care. Okay, well, the jury nailed that one. I think it was the way he told it.
It was just sort of so matter of fact that I bought it. All right, let's go to John. Hello, John.
Hey, Art.
Extinguish your device.
Oh, I have.
Thank you. Somebody wrote a poem up on the website called "Extinguish Your Device," I think. Anyway,
I saw it.
I haven't seen it yet.
I've been waiting here for about 15 minutes, just sitting here listening along and waiting to extinguish my device. So.
All right. Well, you have done so, and you have a story. Proceed.
Yes, I do. So about 2 years ago, I moved in to an apartment with my girlfriend, now my fiancé.
Ah.
But at the time, it was my girlfriend. And she had told me for months previous that she, at nighttime, she would see things randomly through the night. She would wake up and see things standing in the corner. And at one time, she saw a man standing in the corner with a scarf on.
Hmm.
And I never thought of anything of it until it was probably about a month or two after we moved into an apartment together. I woke up one night and I felt something playing with my feet.
Yeah.
And so I freak out, right? And I jump up and I start swatting at something playing with my feet. And it felt like probably like, I would guess, a golf ball sized mouse running over one foot under the other and going back over that foot under the other.
Hmm.
And so, of course, she thought I was just dreaming about it that night.
Yes.
And so as I'm swatting at my feet, she's telling me to calm down, calm down. And all I could think about was her telling me about how she saw things staring at her at nighttime. And I calmed down eventually. But right before I was about to go to sleep, I feel these things playing with my feet again. So I jump up and I start swatting at my feet again, and freaking her out, freaking the dog out, who sleeps between us. And I mean, and since then I've woke up once before, once again, experiencing sleep paralysis and seeing this tall, dark being staring at me during sleep paralysis.
All right. Well, now how can a jury judge this?
I mean, they really can. I mean, it's really me telling the story and them saying whether or not I'm full of it or not. But all I know for sure is I felt something playing with my feet
one night. Rats on the feet, right?
Right, right.
All right, so rats on the feet. Jury, very quickly, Sharon, you're laughing. Truth or trash?
I'm sorry. Well, John, I'm going to say it's, trash.
Okay, Steve.
It sounds really silly. It sounds like Elton John or something is playing with his feet. I'm going to say trash.
Yeah. Lewis?
Sounds like he has cockroach problems.
Yeah.
Trash.
Trash. Okay, and Ed?
I want to say truth because I believe he believes that happened, and there is a version of sleep paralysis where that can occur.
There is. All right. So is it truth or trash, caller?
Well, all I know is you're playing
truth or trash.
Philadelphia Freedom. It's truth.
All right,
this
truth.
John is being truthful with you.
Thank you very much. We'll be right back.
Raging into the night with Midnight in the Desert. To be part of the show, please call 1-952-CALL-ART. That's 1-952-225-5278.
Well, all right. Welcome back, everybody. This is hard. It's really hard because I had in mind to do it a whole different way. But in fact, we're going to do it. Don't worry. Let me be sure of my jury. I know, Sharon, you're there, right?
Yes, sir.
And I think, Lewis, you're there?
Yeah, I'm here. Hey,
and
Art.
We've got a new member, I think, Diane. Is that correct?
Yes, and I am from the Talking Art Bell Midnight in the Desert Facebook group.
Way to give a plug.
And this is a group of people, yes.
I know what they
and
are.
Dino is, yes, and Dino is still waiting to get through.
Okay. All right, and who's our other juror?
Ed, I'm still here.
Ed?
Yes, sir, I'm still here.
All right, Ed. All right, that is our jury. Sharon, Lewis, Diane, and Ed. And here is our next story. It's going to come from Chris. Hello, Chris.
Hello.
Hi.
Wow, it's amazing to be on air with you.
Well, that's what you should expect when you call.
Here's my story.
Well, okay, you got to get good and close to your microphone, Chris. Look for it on the computer. It'll be a little round hole there. You need to get right up to it.
I'm not using the computer. I'm using my Android.
Okay, in that case, you need to not be on the speakerphone.
Okay.
Okay, switch to being on the phone itself. That's very important, folks. You don't want to be on the speakerphone. You want to be on the phone. Well, looks like Chris dumped us by mistake, so sorry about that, Chris. Let's try Andy. Hello, Andy.
Yeah, I'm here.
You also are almost impossible to hear.
Can you hear me?
No, you're mostly not there, Andy, but thanks for trying. See, that's why I try to get people set up. Let's try Peter. Hello, Peter.
Wait. Can I pick up?
Peter, yes?
Hello.
Hello.
Oh, yeah, we got you. Okay. Beautiful. Fantastic. Right.
Peter, talk directly into your device and turn off.
Yeah. Got it.
You've got me on speakerphone, don't you?
No, I got you on Skype right now.
Right, but it's on speakerphone, though.
Yes.
Turn it off and just talk into the phone.
Oh. Okay, talking to the phone.
Yes, the phone. Don't put us on speakerphone. That's...
Well, I'm going to have to show on the phone running. Then I don't... Let me see. I don't know how to do this. Oh, shoot. Can I talk now?
All I can say is you're going to have to get...
Yeah. Okay.
See, it's all a big mess when we're on speakerphone.
You put me on speakerphone, don't
you? Just doesn't work.
No, I got you on Skype right now.
Okay, sorry, can't do that. See, that's a lesson, everybody. Do not put it on speakerphone. Talk directly into your phone. Hello, Mike. Trying for
yes,
Mike.
Yes, can you hear me, Art?
I hear you just fine, Mike. Hi.
How you doing?
Good. Do you have a story?
Yeah. Yeah, my story is about my cat.
Okay.
It was many, many years ago, and I woke up crying, and my wife asked me, what's wrong? And I said, my cat, Kicker, Kicker as in punch and kick, my cat, Kicker, is dead.
Oh.
And I had just had a dream. And in my dream, I woke up crying. My wife asking me what's wrong. I said, my cat is dead. I run through the kitchen, the living room, put my knees on the couch, look out the front porch window. And in my dream, he's laying there dead. I wake up, picking up where I left off. She says that. I run through the kitchen, living room. I put my knees on the couch. I look out the window, and he's laying there exactly the way I saw him in the dream, and he's dead.
Oh, my God. That really is something. Okay, I'll let the jury go at that. Sharon, sad story. What do you think? True?
Well, as a jurist, can I ask a question?
Yes, absolutely. Sure.
Okay, I want to ask him, how old was Kicker?
If I remember right, he was middle-aged, probably about 7, 6.
Okay. And when you saw him lying there dead, where was he exactly when you saw him as you were looking out the window?
Oh, right below the window. Right below the window on the front porch of the house.
Just like in the dream.
Just like
exactly
in
the dream.
Okay, I will give you a true story there, Mike.
Okay. Lewis?
I'm going to say that it's true just because it's a sad kitty story.
Boy, it is. It really is. Diane?
I would have to say it's true, too.
Wow. They're buying it. Ed?
I'll make it unanimous true.
It is unanimous. All right. Now the absolute truth.
Uh-oh.
Or is it trash?
Okay, unfortunately, Art, it is true. This actually happened.
Oh.
It was very sad for me.
Oh, that is sad and amazing also, actually. So,
yeah,
all right.
One of the most amazing things that ever happened to me.
Yeah, amazingly sad, but thank you very much for the attempt. That's really pretty amazing and pretty awful. Huh, pretty awful, I would say. Okay, let's go to Kal, K-A-A-L, is that right?
Yes, that's right.
Hi, where are you, Kal?
South Africa, I'm the second caller.
Oh, that's right. Okay, all right. Yes, yes, go ahead if you have the story.
All right. This is the history of the moon as I research the history of the moon.
Well, I don't get it.
Okay, it starts 500,000 years ago.
Okay, we can't take the history of the moon, Cal. Not here.
Yes,
you have to have a story.
Yeah, that's why I asked. I knew you were not going to take it.
No.
Okay, then can I go to my second story then?
If you have an actual story, Cal.
Yes, this is an actual one from me.
Okay.
All right, happened about 15, 20 years ago. I was staying with a friend in another town here. Stayed there for a year. It was nice with me. I managed to get some money. And then eventually I got my money and I said, all right, now I'm going to go to the bar. I'm going to buy a beer. And so I went. I walked because I didn't have a car then. I walked about 15 minutes to get there just before the bar closed. I went in. I asked them for a beer. I was ready to buy. And then the manager turned around to me and said, sorry, we are closed. We just closed.
Yes.
And then I got so angry. And I turned around to everyone and said, come on, how can it be? I walked 30 minutes to get here.
Yes.
I've got the bucks. Please give me a beer.
Yes.
And again, the guy turned around to me and he smiled a little macho smile at me and he said, sorry, we are closed. And then I got angry. Then I got out. I walked
outside. Okay, we're short on time now, so we got to get to the end of this.
I walked outside of the bar.
Yes.
I walked to the corner of the streets, I turned around at the bar and I screamed at the top of my lungs.
Yeah.
No! And then straight after that, two blocks of lights either way from me blinked out and the whole place was dark. The whole street lights blanked out for two blocks from there. That's my story.
So you shouted the lights out?
It was the emotional anger inside me.
That blew out the lights. That's it. Okay, all right, all right. What do you guys think? Truth or trash?
I don't like it. I think it's trash, trash, trash.
Okay, that's Sharon?
Yes.
Trash. Okay, Lewis?
I think he lived in a sketchy neighborhood, and the bombs probably took out his life.
Yeah, okay. Diane?
Well, I would say that he was desperately needing a drink, if that really happened.
Sounded like it, yeah. Trash, okay. Ed?
I'm going to say trash. There's no specials on TV in the past about people that have the ability to do that.
I know. Saw it on TV. All right. Sorry, buddy. They think that's absolute trash, all four of them. Are you going to tell me it's true?
I'm going to tell you that this is definitely true. There was a power box next
Okay, that's all I need. Thank you. It's definitely true, huh? So the jury got it all wrong. You know what, though? I'm with the jury. This is somebody named NB, I believe. Hello. Is NB correct? Maybe not. Wait a minute. Somebody's on hold here. This Skype is messing with me. NB, hello. Going once, going twice, gone. Let's start fresh and try with, my goodness, A-N-K-H, is that right?
Yeah, that's good enough, Art.
How do I pronounce that?
Let's go with Ankh. I've got a story I've been trying to tell you for about 2 or 3 weeks since you started asking about September.
Okay.
So, first an A-L-M-A-O to some of my friends out there, and, about March of this year, I was walking outside of where I work, and I just look up in the sky, and it's kind of dark over in the distance. And, you know, I'm out there for a bit waiting for my bus, so I make a couple calls, and I turn back around, and there's this huge beam of light just coming down over this building in the distance. So, you know, it's weird, but I don't think anything of it, because, you know, weather's weird, stuff happens like that. But about every 2 weeks since then, I've been having these visions at night, And it's nothing big and fantastic. It's just like I'm sitting in my room in the vision, watching the TV. And
sir, how can a jury judge this?
Well, about as well as they can judge a cat falling from a tree, I guess.
Well, I don't know. Maybe. I mean, this is like a UFO sighting, kind of, right?
Well, no, because the beam of light wasn't coming down. It was coming up from this building.
Okay.
So it's something, you know, originating on the planet.
Okay.
Like a signal beam. So then, in these visions since then, I've been seeing things, and 2 weeks later, they've been on the TV.
I see.
So I am predicting the future through my visions of television broadcasts. And they have cut out exactly coinciding with the start of September.
All right. Well, I'm ruling that one unjudgeable. I mean, you just see, folks, you can't judge that kind of thing. I appreciate the effort, but there's no way to judge it. Hello, Barbara.
Yes. Hi.
Hi. Do you have a good story for us?
Yes, I do. Way back when, I used to go to Farmingdale College on Long Island.
Okay.
And they had a concert for the college, and me and my friend decided to go to it. It was the Kinks.
Oh, yes, but, I remember them.
Yeah, and of course, you know, we decided to sneak in. So it was like 4 in the afternoon, 3 or 4 in the afternoon when we decided to do this. The concert was held in a gymnasium. So we go in there, and the bleachers are pulled down on one side of the room. And there's these guys sitting on the bleachers. They kind of look like English guys, you know?
Yes.
They had long hair. They were playing cards.
Okay.
So they asked me and my friend if we'd like to play cards with them. We were kind of shy, and we said no. And they said they were playing whisk. And we kind of thanked them, and we went and we sat down in one of the chairs, and we were embarrassed because we were sneaking into this concert. So we were in there like 2 or 3 hours waiting for the concert. Finally, it's time. People start coming in. We're sitting in the front row. The guys come out, the Kinks. It's the Roadies.
Mm-hmm.
They gave us this kind of, the lead singer kind of leaned forward, gave us a wink and a smile. And we were pretty humiliated because we didn't pay for the concert. And that's my story.
That's it. So you that's snuck it. Into a concert.
Yes.
I'm not sure how they would judge that.
Well.
I guess we can try.
All right.
Sharon?
Well, thanks for your confession, Barbara, and I think it's a true story.
True. Okay.
Yes.
Lewis?
I think it's a true story. She sounds like a groupie.
It's a cruel jury. Diane?
I think it's a true story, and I hope you let us tell a story at the end as well.
Okay. Ed?
I'll say it's true.
True. All right. 4 say it's true. Is it true?
Yes.
All right. Well, Yay. Thank you. Thank you for the... that's one the jury got absolutely right. Let's try Peter. Hello, Peter.
Oh, yeah. Odd.
Yes, yes.
Perfect. My wife is here. She has a story for you, Odd.
Your wife?
Yeah, Sherry.
Sherry.
Hi, yes. We're using his computer.
Okay.
Okay. So a number of years ago when I was at work, I had a lady come in off the street, and I don't know if you've ever experienced that or those that have worked in an office and somebody comes in and tries to sell you things off the street. So I ended up buying this cute little farm duck, and it was a stuffed animal. And when you tapped it on its head, it would play or quack out 3 different songs right in a row, like quack, 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 like the thing. And then Frere Jacques, quack, 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 quack. Anyway, so the whole idea was this stuffed animal would only quack out like 3 songs without separate notes. So I took this thing home for my children. I raised 2 boys,
right.
And they were teenage boys. And one day I had this thing in my son's room, my younger son's room, and I was vacuuming while the kids were at school, and this thing started quacking at me separate notes while I was about 10 feet away. So that kind of freaked me out. I shut the vacuum cleaner off, ran downstairs, and the boys came home, And I was still shaking, and I said, this is what happened. We all went upstairs, and they were, of course, laughing and quite cynical about it. And we started asking it questions. And I said, okay, if this is for real, one quack for yes, two quacks for no. And the boys, of course, are laughing hysterically. And sure enough, within about 10 seconds of me asking the first question, are you related to one of our family members that has passed? And about 10 seconds later, through their hysteria and laughing, it quacked once for yes.
Wow.
Yeah, so it was pretty freaky. And this carried on a few more questions. And at the end of the third or fourth question, that was enough for my boys. My younger son literally went over to the little stuffed animal, picked it up, and wrenched it across to the other side of the room, and it shattered, and a few little feathers came out.
Very smart child.
Yeah, so I ended up with a possessed stuffed animal in my home.
that's a good story. Hold on. All right, jury, you can ask questions or render a verdict. Sharon?
Well, Sherry, I think you're telling a true story, and I'd really like to hear you crack out that song again.
Yeah, it was good. Lewis?
A Ouija duck? I say yes, true story.
True story. Pretty scary. All right, Diane?
Mm-hmm. I have to agree with everyone else. I think it's a true story.
True story. Guys really buy into this stuff. All right, Ed?
I'm going to say it's a true story, but most likely a defective item.
Yeah, all right. Well, all right, so is it truth or trash, caller?
That's an absolutely true story.
A true story. Can you quack it out once more for us?
You want all three songs?
Well, not all three, no. I just...
Quack, 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 quack.
That'll do. Thank you very much. All right. That was in the spirit of exactly what I want. Let's go to Frank. Wherever Frank is, it's your turn.
Yes, hello, Art Bell.
Hi.
I'm calling from Denver.
Excellent.
Any more room for jury members tonight? A little bit late for that?
No, I could form another jury, but I mean, I kind of like this jury. They have a sense of humor.
Well, hey, I tell you, I would contribute. I'm pretty fair, and I've heard paranormal stories.
You don't have to sell yourself as a juror. Do you have a story, though?
Yes, I actually do. So when I was about 18, I went to Deadwood out in South Dakota.
Oh, yes.
A family trip. And when I was out there, my parents decided to stay in this old casino type of hotel. And it was a very old place, and, you know, I grew up watching horror films and whatnot, so naturally I was a bit nervous, as I am right now. You know, once again, I'm a huge fan. I've been listening since I've been 6 years old. Wow.
And what, you're 90 now?
So, I'm there at the hotel, and I'm underage, so my parents go gambling, and they're like, well, you can go on up to the hotel and wait for us up there. So give me the key. I go up to the hotel, and our room's at the very end of this long hallway. And I'm walking down the hallway, have the key in my hand, and find the door. The key number matches the door, so I start to put the key into the door, turn it. It won't go in. And at the very same
time... All right,
time,
that's where you've got to stop your story. I've got a break,
sure.
Which I have to do.
Midnight in the desert doesn't screen calls. We trust you, but remember, the NSA... Well, you know. To call the show, please dial 1-952-225-5278. That's 1-952-CALL-ART.
Well, there you have it. All right. Let us bring back our caller. Hi there. You had a key in your hand, I believe, and we're headed for the door.
Yes, Art Bell, really quick, in case anyone's just now tuning in, very short recap. I was out in Deadwood, stayed in an old hotel. I'm on a family vacation with my parents. So, yes, I'm in an old casino hotel. You know, my parents are gambling, they give me the key, and they say, hey, go on up to the room, you know, we'll be up there later. So, I find the room number, it's at the very end of a very long hallway. And, you know, I have the key in my hand, it matches the room number, so I'm there with the key, and I insert it into the door, it's not going in. And at the same time, you know, I'm struggling trying to get it in, it's not going in. at the very end of the hallway, I look to my right at the very end of the hallway, and I see a bluish orb floating mid in the air, just kind of floating there, kind of moving almost like in a circular, but kind of like in a random type of way.
Yeah.
I'm feeling extremely fearful. I start nervously, you know, shaking, sweating, a million thoughts are shooting through my head. And, you know, then it just, in an instant, it just goes away. The second that it goes away, the key goes right into the door, and I get into the room.
Okay.
And once I got into the room, you know, I was so freaked out, I ran back downstairs and waited for my parents, and then I slept in the car that night.
Pretty interesting, but it's very hard for a jury to judge something like that. A blue orb.
Sure, yeah. It's maybe one of the jury members had a similar experience or, you know, something like that. So
I think that's
I
the only thing
to,
that's going
to
help you. All right, let me find out. Let's see who we've got here. We've got most of our jury left. I think we've got a new jury member from Kirkfield, Ontario. Is that correct?
That's correct, Art.
Okay. All right, so let's do it one at a time. Sharon, blue orb story. What do you think?
Frank, is it? Well, you're well spoken, well told. I'm going to say it's true.
Okay. Lewis.
I'm going to say he's telling the truth. It sounds like something that could happen.
Okay.
Some weird remote time.
I think we lost Diane, and so our new juror is
Terry.
Terry, and what do you think, Terry?
I like the way he delivered the story. It sounded very matter-of-factly, and he presented it very well. I bought it. I say it's true.
That's true. And who's left? Ed?
Yes, sir. I'm going to say trash. The part about him sleeping in the car is what broke it for me. So.
Gotcha. Oh. All right. Well, so
fair enough.
Now the truth, please.
Yes, absolutely true, 100%. As I said, I was about, 16, 17 when that happened. And
okay, good enough. I appreciate the answer. Thank you. And let's see if I can straighten everything out here. This has been tough tonight because I expected to do it sort of an opposite way from this. Nevertheless, let us proceed with Marvin. Hello, Marvin.
Hello, Mark.
Marvin, you sound very far away from your computer, and it's hard to hear you.
I'm using a headset.
Pardon me?
I'm using a headset.
Now you sound good, Marvin.
Okay. Well, I've got a story.
Okay.
Now, this happened about 13 years ago, and I had gotten sick with, you know, my doctor diagnosed me as having some kind of pneumonia.
Okay.
And after I had been home for about, 2 weeks or so, I went to bed, and then I had kind of a dream or kind of a vision.
Okay, again, this is going to be very hard for people to judge.
But there is a right. real living right. element to it.
All right.
And what happened was I saw strange robed figures, very tall, but they didn't really seem human. And they were playing some kind of game using stones with symbols carved on them.
Yes.
And there was a giant octagonal kind of, board
yeah.
on the floor wherever they were at. And they were playing this game, and I was watching them do it, and they were moving these stones. But gradually, the symbols on them turned to characters I could recognize, just plain English text. And it said, "You shall not die here." And I woke up from that dream, and I wasn't really sure what it was about. But the next day, my illness got worse. And my parents actually drove me to the hospital. And it was at Beaumont Hospital. And the lobby in that hospital, when I looked up at the ceiling from the wheelchair they had me in, that ceiling, and I'd never been there before, But that ceiling was, the room was roughly octagonally shaped and had black and white tiles. And looking up at that, I felt a lot better. I felt like I was in the right place. And I was in that hospital for actually a whole month, and actually underwent a lung surgery there, which still frightened me nonetheless, but I felt that I had something going for me, and I actually pulled through.
What was wrong with you? Why did you need lung surgery?
I had too much fluid in my lungs.
That'll
do it. Actually, put a chest tube in.
And so your dream was you'd be okay, and the answer was you were okay.
Yes.
After a month
in
the hospital.
I connected what I saw in that dream with what I saw in that lobby on the ceiling.
Okay. All right. Jury, any questions?
Well, it's me, Sharon. I'm getting a little bit of static, Art, but I was going to say I've had pneumonia myself, but haven't had that. I'm glad that you're with us still. I don't know what to say. I'll just say I'm sure it's true.
Okay. Lewis?
Sounds like the good stuff kicked in, so I'm going to say it's true.
Terry?
I have concerns about his oxygen level to his brain at the time. I'm going to call trash.
Trash, okay. Ed?
I'll say it's true, but I'm sure it was a hallucination.
Well, okay. All right. So, what say you, caller?
From my perspective, at least, it did happen. And
okay, so you're saying it's true?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much for the call, and take care. From your perspective, it happened. Interesting. Hello, Scott.
Hey, Art. How's it going?
It's going well. Do you have a story?
Hello, jury. I've got a nice story for you.
All right. Go ahead.
All right. 1973, I got my first job in radio.
Mm-hmm.
I was at it for several months and was driving in to do the morning shift, 5 a.m. to 9 a.m. And about 10 minutes before I got to the station, the radio went dead. And I checked the radio, and all the other stations were coming in okay. So I switched back to our station. Still nothing. So, like I say, I'm 10 minutes out from the station. I pull into the little parking lot, go into the building, and there, lying in the hallway, is the overnight guy, dead.
Oh, my God.
So, self-inflicted gunshot wound.
Uh-huh.
And I walk into the studio to pick up the phone and call the cops, and I look down on the desk at the program log, and the final entry, which coincided with the time the radio went dead, was suicide.
Oof. Wow, what a story. Holy mackerel, Scott. All right, hold on. Don't go anywhere, Scott. My goodness, what a story. Dead DJ, big time. Sharon?
Well, I can't relate like you can, Art, but I'll say that's a true one.
True one. All right. Lewis?
I'll say it's a true story just because crazy things have been happening with you. Personalities and stuff like that. So, yes, true.
They have, and very recently, too. Terry?
Yep. I'd like to ask Scott a question.
Okay, go ahead.
Scott, what is an Arbitron?
Arbitron is a company in, I think, Hyattsville or Beltsville, Maryland, that does the ratings for radio stations.
Good one. All right. Terry?
Okay, I'll say true.
Okay. And finally, Ed.
I'm going to say trash, because I would find it hard to believe there's no other people in the building at the time.
Well, no, wait a minute. It was the overnight guy. All right, well, anyway, trash it is. All right, Scott, time for the truth.
Well, Art and three-quarters of the panel, I am happy to say I got you guys, but not the last guy. strangely enough, actually, the station was about 40 miles outside of D.C. in the burbs back in 73, so there wouldn't have been anybody overnights. But that story actually did happen at another place.
Well, that's all right. You know, you're allowed to lie. That's the whole point of this thing.
I thought I'd spring it on you guys, and I was three-quarters of the way successful.
You were. Thank you very much. We're going to break here, and then we'll come back to our jury and our stories. You know, I actually bought that one. I could kind of see that happen. Anyway, this is Midnight in the Desert. Stay right there.
Strike 12, and Midnight in the Desert is pounding packets your way on the Dark Matter Digital Network. To call the show, please direct your finger digits to dial 1-952-225-5278. That's 1-952-CALL-ART.
By the way, I'm sorry, we lost one of our jury members earlier. She wanted to tell a story, so she probably split, I think it was Diane, to try and tell a story instead. So if I see Diane calling, I'll try and get her as quickly as I can. In the meantime, let's give a shot. Let's try Jim. Hello, Jim.
Hey, Art. I'm calling from Washington, D.C. I got a story for you.
Absolutely. Go ahead.
My first wife and I, we lived in a house on top of the hill next to Arlington Cemetery here.
Mm-hmm.
And there were some nights when she seemed to be harassed by these unseen energies. She would, like, sit up in bed and swat at them and yell at them.
Right.
And it was a fairly common occurrence. And one night, just after I'd gone to bed, she was already asleep. She sat up, started yelling at them, swatting at them like that. And she was completely unresponsive to me. I couldn't, couldn't get her to stop or, you know, acknowledge me or anything.
You couldn't see a thing.
I didn't see a thing.
All right.
So that evening, I'd been reading a book that offered techniques for protecting yourself from malevolent energies.
Mm-hmm.
And the author spoke of visualizing a white light and surrounding yourself with it and expanding it to push these things away.
Heard about that?
Yep. So I closed my eyes and I started the process. I started to visualize the white light. And when I felt that I was surrounded with that, I expanded it to surround the entire bed. And then I further increased it to engulf the entire house. And it was at precisely this point, she turns at me and grabs my arm and yells, "What did you do?" I said, "What do you mean?" She said, "You put something around the house."
Really?
I almost had a heart attack.
Yes.
I was doing this only in my mind. I had never mentioned the technique to her at all before.
Wow.
And the next day she had no recollection of what had happened.
Oh my God. What a story. All right. I like the story. Jury, what do you all think of it? Sharon?
Oh, that one gives me the heebie-jeebies.
Yeah.
I will say, considering that I was bamboozled the last time, okay, I'm going to say it's true.
It's true. All right. Lewis?
I'm going to say it's true as well.
All right, that's two. Terry?
There's just a little bit too much coincidence in the whole story. I'm going to say trash.
All right, so splitting. And Ed?
I'll say true.
True.
Since Arlington was originally owned by Robert E. Lee, it might have been the ghost of the Confederate soldiers being pissed off or something, I guess. So I'll say true.
All right. All right. So there you have it. One, two, three trues. What's the absolute truth, please?
Art, I've been wanting to tell you this story on the air for close to 20 years now. It's absolutely true.
Wow. Wow. All right. Well, no matter how you look at it, it's a cool story. You were doing that in your mind, and what a story. Excellent. All right, let's go to, I think it's Jim, if he's there. Are you there, Jim? No, he's not. Let's go to Rob. Hello, Rob.
Hi.
Hi.
I'm calling from the land of the midnight sun in Anchorage, Alaska.
Way up north.
Yep, and my story is this. So when I was 16 or 17... I lived with my mom and dad along with my my whole family. My older sister used to get really bad nightmares, mm-hmm. and she used to sleepwalk very, very bad.
Right.
She would have dreams that she was at work, she would act out her work. She was even like a pirate queen one time, and she was shouting "burn them all" and laughing maniacally, but one night she was on our love seat crouching because we were trying to get her to, you know, calm down, and she jumped 20 feet from the middle of the room up onto this professional speaker system that we had.
20 feet?
Yep.
My God.
Straight up.
To a speaker system.
Yep. It wasn't straight up. It was over and up.
Over and up, but a total of 20 feet.
The speaker system was about... Yeah, it was crazy. The speaker system was about five feet off the ground. So she was up and over.
Good thing you didn't have surround sound. So that's a true story. You're telling me that's a true story, right? How do you think the jury will see that? A 20-foot jump is like superhuman.
That story is actually not true. Okay. It was only 10 feet. But it was pretty impressive.
You shouldn't have told me that. You just spoiled. We didn't even check with the jury yet.
Oh.
Even a 10-foot jump is pretty outstandingly crazy. What do you guys think?
Rob, I have a question for you.
All right.
Yes. Your sister, you said, slept walk a lot. So you said just a moment ago you're trying to get her to calm down. I thought you weren't supposed to disturb someone when they're sleepwalking.
Yeah.
Well, I know that, but we were really afraid that she was going to hurt herself because there was a couple times she was, like, heading to work, and she grabbed her keys and was starting to go out the door. So we were mainly just trying to keep her corralled.
And she actually jumped 10 feet.
It was 10 feet.
I will say, Rob, I'm going to say it's trash.
Trash. Okay, Sharon, I'm not buying that one. Lewis?
I'm going to say trash because, no one can jump 10 feet. No one.
That's right. Terry?
Rob, it sounds like nobody had a measuring tape that night. Can't quite decide. I'm gonna have to say trash.
Trash. All right, that's three trash. And Ed?
Quick question. How many stories was the home you lived in?
Just one.
It was just a one story. I'm going to say trash as well.
All right. Thoroughly, completely trashed. Now, the real truth is or isn't 10 feet.
It was 10 feet over. She jumped. It was the weirdest thing that I have ever seen, and she landed right on top of this of the speaker and perched there. It was one of the craziest things I've seen in my life.
For real true, huh?
For real true.
All right, buddy. Thank you very much for the call and the story. I, too, had a sister that sleepwalked, and while you're not supposed to wake them up, indeed, they can do damage. I mean, something bad can happen, so I kind of get it. But 10 feet up onto a speaker, holy moly. Let's try, I think it's Mike, is that right?
That's correct, Art.
Hello, Mike. Do you have a story?
I do.
Good.
8 years ago, I had a cyst, and it was, let's say...
Where?
An unmentionable reason.
It was in a what?
Unmentionable reason.
Okay, a cyst in a bad place. Yeah, we get it.
Okay. They're called pilonidal cysts.
How big was this cyst?
Oh, about the size of three thumbs.
That's a big cyst.
I couldn't sit down. I couldn't sleep. And I went and had it removed.
Uh-huh.
I woke up from anesthesia.
Uh-huh.
And the doctor came in and said, well, we got some news for you. He said they got it all, and all was good. But they found teeth, hair.
Oh my God.
And a small bit of brain matter.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
For real, huh? Okay. For real. All right.
I'm not finished yet.
Okay, go ahead.
We did some DNA testing on it.
Yes.
And found out it was my twin.
Boy, we had one other story like this, sort of.
And we actually had it buried in the family plot.
Oh my God.
It was horrible.
Yeah. Right. All right. I don't know what to do with that story. Jury. Good luck with this one.
Gross. Well, I want to know is how long has this cyst been on you, or were you living with this?
How long had it been there? Yes.
Yes.
Well, it didn't really start bothering me until, it was a couple months where it really got really bad. But, I'm guessing it had been in there since I was born.
Okay.
You wouldn't notice it, like prior to it beginning to hurt you, you didn't notice it at all prior to this pain?
Honestly, I thought it was just part of my tailbone.
Yeah.
Part of your tailbone?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm going to say true.
Okay. Lewis?
I'm going to say that it's true. It could happen.
I hate to think of teeth in there, though. All right, Terry?
Well, he does have the cyst in the right location. It would be at the tailbone. I'm just trying to decide if the rest of it is true. And I'm going to give him the benefit of the doubt.
True. All right, Ed?
True.
Well, I will say trash because I've also had a polynodal cyst in that same exact spot, and they are started by ingrown hairs, not twins.
So. All right, let's find out what's for real and what's not. Mike, it's time for the truth.
Oh, no.
It's so much trash.
It's trash?
It's trash.
See, but you know how to lie, buddy.
Yeah.
You got him.
Liar.
Good on you, Ed. Good on you.
All right. All right, everybody, hold on. We might have time to do, let's go here. Hello there, Ryan, I believe.
Hey, Art, how's it going?
It's going well, Ryan. Where are you?
I'm in Mount Pleasant, North Carolina.
Excellent. Okay, well, the jury listens.
Okay, about 20 years ago, I lived in Raleigh, North Carolina, and I'm a musician, but I was working in a sign shop at the time, and this guy walked in one day, and he asked, how big can you make signs? And I mean, that's a really general question. I'm like, oh, well, I don't know how big you need to make it.
Uh-huh.
And, he's like, well, I've got kind of an odd request. I said, okay, well, what is it? He says, I want to communicate with aliens.
Huh.
And I want to make some symbols that'll go on the side of a mountain. And wow. He had my attention immediately.
I'm sure.
And I'm like, okay, well, I gave him a couple of suggestions. I was like, look, man, you know, if you're, you know, really wanting to do this, we can come up with a way to make it happen. How big do you want to go? And he's like, well, I was thinking 100, 150 feet per character.
Right.
And I'm like, well, what kind of characters are you going to make to communicate with aliens?
Right.
And he was like, well, I've got some symbols.
Okay.
And I'm like, okay, fair enough. And, you know, I couldn't spend that much time with it. So we talked a little more about how we would actually fabricate these things. He thanked me and went on his way. And over the years, you know, I've thought about it here, there, and, you know, just briefly it'll pop into my head and whatnot. Well, the more I think about it, I remember what the guy sounded like. I remember what the guy looked like. I think it was Dr. Stephen Greer.
Oh, really? Dr. Stephen Greer, the Dr. Stephen Greer we interview from time to time here.
Exactly. He's from North Carolina.
Right.
He was going to do this in the Appalachian Mountains.
Cool. Might be something Dr. Greer would have done, too.
And, yeah, I mean, it sounds like the kind of thing he would do.
It really does. And you've seen photographs of Dr. Greer since, I presume.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And
so you know, are you suggesting to us that it was, in fact, Dr. Greer?
I think so.
All right, hold it right there. We will come back to you after the break, okay? That's an amazing story. Don't hang up. Just stay there, Mark. This is Midnight in the Desert.
Not radio, but it is.
It's my private pleasure. He didn't finish.
To initiate a dialogue sequence with Art Bell, please coordinate your phalanges and call 1-952-225-5278. That's 1-952-CALL-ART.
Technology. Okay, so unfortunately, unless he calls back, we lost Ryan. I'm sorry about that, Ryan. Although, it sounded as though... There's Ryan. There's Ryan Good. Hello, Ryan. Hello, Ryan.
I'm back.
Good. All right, judgment time. And it's a pretty cool story, actually. Sharon, what do you think? Could that have been the real thing?
Well, I think, Art, by your response, I'm going by how you responded with almost delight learning who this person was.
Well, my delight was just thinking about the possibility, because it's really something that he might have done.
True. I'm going to say true.
True. Okay. All right. So she's going by what I said. Lewis?
I'm going to say true as well, just because the guy, I heard the interview, and it sounds like something he'd do.
It does. Terry?
It does. Kind of weird.
Okay, I think this is a masterfully constructed lie.
Okay.
He's crafted it so well, and he's got you to buy in on it, kind of on a personal level.
Yeah, you're right.
You might know, and everything. I'm going to say trash.
Okay, all right, you've said it. Ed?
I'm going to say trash as well, because I would have been like, sure, I can build you anything you want. Here's my price.
All right. Well, then that splits the jury right down the middle. So, Ryan, the truth, please.
I swear to God it happened.
It okay.
Oh,
with a caveat.
Yes?
It was 20 years ago.
Uh-huh.
And I've seen his movie. I've seen some clips of him on YouTube.
Yes.
It could be my brain.
All right. All right. Well, look, I'll settle this once and for all, because I'm going to have him on the show, and I will ask him, okay?
Please do.
All right.
That'd be great.
All right. All right. Jury, thank you. Hold on, jury. And we will get back to you. In the meantime, I think we will go to Amy. Are you there?
Hi, it's Amy. It's the Haunted Skeptic. How are you?
I'm fine. Fine, Amy. Do you have a story for us?
Yes, I do. I get really nervous thinking about this story because it happened about 5 years ago.
Okay.
I was out on a road trip with my girlfriend. We were doing this great American road trip through the Southwest. It was wonderful, brilliant. But we were on our way back home, and we were taking this route through West Texas, and we had some car trouble. So it was getting like, it was really late in the day. And as you probably know, it's like, there's no cellular reception out there in West Texas in a lot of places. It's really spotty.
Right. Every time, even in movies, when people get in trouble and monsters and bad people come, there's never cell reception. Never.
I know, right? Well, I've driven plenty of places. I am a road trip queen. I love my road trips. I've hardly ever had like any issues going out on road trips or anything. But
gotcha.
Back to the story. So. Started having some car trouble, and we had like no cellular reception, and it was around the end of the day, but I had remembered passing like this house about maybe a mile or so back.
Mm-hmm.
And so after walking for a little bit, we came upon this I guess it was like a farmhouse. So we knocked on the door and we asked if we could use the phone, and this guy answers, and he just tells us he's like a caretaker there for the owner, but they didn't actually have a phone there. So it was getting late, but he said that we could go ahead and stay overnight, and he promised to drive us to the nearest town the next morning, which was probably about maybe 50 miles away. So what could we do? We said, okay, it was better than sleeping in the car.
Sure.
So it was totally weird, though. The guy had, like, no food. We just sat there maybe for the better part of an hour, and he just stared at us, like, before he offered to let us go ahead and sleep in, like, one of the guest rooms or something. And so I decided, okay, well, I'm getting tired. I don't want to just sit there and stare at this guy anymore for the rest of the night.
Okay.
So I went off to get changed, and I had this really funny feeling. And I just kind of out of the corner of my eye, I glanced out the window, and I noticed the guy was peeking in on me from the outside.
Mm.
And I did not want to say anything. I didn't want to act startled or anything. I just kind of turned around slowly. I was going to go and get my girlfriend. I think she was, like, outside looking for a dog or something. She'd let her dog out because we'd had it on the trip too. But then I turned around and like there he was. He was right there in front of my face. And so I was thinking, how in the world is this possible? And then he started talking like really nice to me. And so I just kind of pushed past him and I decided, okay, well, I'm going to go and find my girlfriend. And so she's probably outside with her dog, and so
what was he saying? Like, I really like you. You're really nice girl.
It was actually kind of like that. I mean, he was talking about my hair and everything, and okay. It was really weird. And
okay,
I was
so
already, like,
we got to get to the end of it. So what happened?
Okay, so getting to the end of it, I went outside and I was looking for my girlfriend. I see this light kind of out in this field back behind the house. And I don't see her anywhere, don't hear the dog. So I decided, okay, well, maybe there's like another house or something over there. Maybe she went to go and talk to somebody else with a phone. So I walked over this light and turns out it's like this giant bonfire. And so I approach like this area, this whole area, and I just see nothing but like maybe, it was like maybe 8 women out there fighting in nightgowns. It was just so strange.
Yeah.
It was the strangest thing. It was like they were in some sort of makeshift temple or something.
Got it.
And then I heard this really loud growl. It's like nothing I have ever heard in my life.
Yes.
And then I turned around again, and I saw this guy. He was this really dark figure. He was really tall, dark figure. He was dressed in these robes, these black robes. And I was just really freaked out about that. And so I ran straight back to the house. I found my girlfriend. She was there. She had not found her dog yet. But she told me, yeah, that she had met the women out there, and they said that they were, like, the wives of like, this guy. And I was like, why? So this is like some strange like polygamous cult thing going on. I don't know. I have no idea. We decided that we were just going to get out of there. And we thought we'd heard her dog like a little bit further down the road.
Okay, we're about out of time here, so real quick.
Okay, but real quick, we walked down the road. Eventually, a cop car drove past. He picked us up, and we told him everything that had happened. And he basically said that nobody had lived there for the better part of a decade after like these 2 vacationers were found dead there. And we never found my girlfriend's dog. It just went completely missing.
That's a hell of a story. All right, let's go to the jury. Sharon?
I don't know what to, Amy, you spin quite the yarn. I'm going to say it's trash.
Trash. All right, that's one. Lewis?
I've lived in, unfortunately lived in Texas and driven through West Texas, and there are some weird things like that out there and weird people. So I'm going to say it's absolutely true because that's something that would happen in Texas.
Oh my God.
Yeah, rap on Texas. Terry?
Well, I think this is straight out of Rod Serling and Night Gallery, so I'm going to say trash.
Trash, okay. And Ed?
I'm going to say trash as well because I'd rather sleep in my car and then a strange home with no phone. So.
All right, that's 3 trashes and a true. What's the? Give us a straight scoop, Amy.
Okay, so the straight scoop is that's just a variation on a really old B-movie called Manos, the Hands of Fate.
B-movie is right.
Whatever.
I knew it.
One of the worst movies of all time.
I told the man when there was no cell service, I knew it. All right. Thank you, Amy. And this is one where you can make up what you want to make up. It's just fine. Let's go to Mark. Hello, Mark. Going once, Mark. Going twice. Gone. Looks like it's going to be Richard. Hello, Richard.
Hey, Art.
Hi.
How you doing?
Fine. Do you have a story, Richard?
Oh, I do, Art.
All right, turn your radio device, whatever, down, off.
I'm going to turn the amp off, Art.
Yes,
do that. The amp's off.
Yes, okay, good. Got a story?
Yes, I do, Art.
Go ahead.
First of all, can I just say, before I start my story, to my stepkids and to my grandchildren in Texas, I love you. And can I also say to everyone at Belgab, I love you too.
Okay.
And everyone who
where
is
are
not
you,
a time
by the way?
Traveler, please sign up. It will cost you £3.50 sterling, €4.40. You will get the best entertainment you have ever got. Please, please, please stand up and keep this man on the radio.
All right. Thank you. That's very kind, Richard. Now, your story.
Well, Art, here's the story. Until I was 14, I did not realize that my parents weren't my parents. Wow. They were my grandparents. So, a lot of your people won't know who this person even is. But back in the day, I was terrified by a guy called Frankenstein in the old black and white movies. Okay. A guy called Boris Karloff.
Mm-hmm.
So I used to go to England from Northern Ireland, and I used to go to England, and I used to see a man who I thought was my brother, but he wasn't my brother, he was actually my father. I didn't realize this, but my father had been a stage hypnotist. And one day he said to me, let's go, we're going to go and have lunch with a man, and his name is Bill Pratt, and we're going to go and have lunch with him.
Mm-hmm.
And we went out and we had lunch, and I'll never forget the woman that served me the what he called. She was the most beautiful of women, not in a playboy sense, but her skin was perfection, or never forget it. I never forget the smell. She served us a little trays, trays of fish pie.
Okay, and the story is?
Well, I was terrified by this guy called Frankenstein.
Mm-hmm.
And he says to me, he says, Richard, this is Bill. This is Bill. And I says, oh, I says, hello, Bill. And I shook his hand. I never forget it. And he took me out into his room. He says, come on. He says, Bill's going to show you who he is. Bill Pratt was Boris Karloff. Boris Karloff.
It was a real Boris Karloff?
It was Boris Karloff. It was Frankenstein. And I never forgot that day. And I was never afraid again, Art. I was never afraid again.
So you met the real Frankenstein?
I met Bill Pratt, and I was never terrified after that. Every time I seen Frankenstein after that, I looked at the black and white movies.
Got it.
And I thought, that's fantastic.
All right. True story, jury? What do you think?
You softened my heart. I think it's that Irish accent.
Yes.
And I could just sit and listen to you all night, but I'm going to say it's not true.
Okay, Trash. And Steve?
Trash.
Lewis, I'm sorry. Trash, okay.
Sorry, Trash.
Two Trash. All right. Terry?
It's a little too convoluted. I'm going to say trash.
Trash. All right. Ed?
Quick question for Richard. What year around did this happen?
This happened in 1974.
Okay. Well, Boris Karloff died in 1969, so it's trash.
Okay. There you go. Okay. Well, I'm afraid you lost that one, buddy. But we appreciate your attempt anyway. It was good. And that was a good catch there. Very good catch, jury. All right. Do we have time for more? I think we do. Let's try Andy. Hello there, Andy, from somewhere. No.
Hey, how's it going, Art?
Okay, I can sort of just barely hear you, Andy. Not a good connection.
I've got my mic right up to my mouth here. Still can't hear me?
No, not a good connection. I can hear you, but it's not a good connection for a story. So you might want to repair that and get back to us. Jacob, we're going to give you a try. Hello, Jacob.
Hello.
Hello.
And good evening to the jury as well. I was calling because I wanted to tell a story about them.
All right, you're going to have to get good and close to your mic there.
Oh, sorry. Is that better?
What are you using?
It's on my webcam, but it's...
Okay, here's what you do, and everybody hear this. Pick the webcam up with your hand and talk into it like a mic.
That's what I had been doing.
Okay.
Okay, so can I go with my story
now? Yes, you may.
All right, so my cat has me trained, basically. She'll jump into my windowsill at night when she wants to come in and, like, slap the window, and I'll go out and get her. But one night it was pretty foggy outside, so I couldn't really see, and I heard the knocking. So I was going on my way out to get her, and I saw a room with a light on, and I went to turn it off because I figured my brothers had left it on when they went to bed, but my cat was in there sleeping, and I ended up not going outside at all.
Okay.
And that's the whole story.
That's the story. Well, I'm not even going to submit that one. Thank you for the attempt, but very quickly, Joe, do you have a story?
Yeah.
Hello?
Can you hear me?
Yeah, now I can.
Okay. Yeah, back in about 2001, I was looking at a photo map.
Okay, your audio is not good, buddy.
Can you hear me now?
A little better. I don't know. What are you using?
It's a Android phone.
An Android phone. Are you speakerphone or what?
How's that?
Oh, God, much better.
Okay. Yeah, back in 2001, I was working at a photo mat in North Carolina inside of a Target. It was like a Kodak booth, you know?
Right.
And there would be this arson investigator that would come in and, you know, maybe a couple times a week, he would have photos developed of different fire scenes he was investigating.
Right.
And the work he did was kind of interesting. So when his photos popped out of the developing machine, I would look at them kind of closely.
Very quickly, because the show is ending on us here. So,
anyways, I pointed out this little, like, burnt can that was in one of the photos, and he said he hadn't noticed it. And he went back to that place, investigated it again.
Right.
Basically, I solved an arson case by looking at a photograph.
Holy mackerel. Congratulations. That is quite a story. All right, jury, that's a good one. What do you think? Sharon?
I'd say true.
True. Lewis?
I'm going to say true as well.
Really? Okay. Let's see. Who have we got left? We've got Ed left. And what do you say, Ed?
I'll say true.
True.
And Terry here, Art, I'll say true.
Okay. Terry, listen, I want to take a moment. Well, first, let's find out. Is it a true story or not?
No, it's completely false. I did see it. I saw a naked rock thing, but I can't talk about that because I don't want to get sued. So.
You tore him up, man. Good job.
Yeah, good one, good one.
Yep, thank you very much. And jury, I want to thank you for your service. I mean, you've been overwhelmingly good, all of you. So.
Oh, thank you, Arthur.
Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Everybody have a good night. Everybody have a good weekend. All right.
Dark matter.
Later, everybody. That was fun. All right. Solved an arson crime. Totally false. Blew them all away. From the high desert, I'm Art Bell. Good night.